الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. Dear brothers and sisters, one of the hard and ultimate truths of life that many people are not willing to admit or don't like to admit is a fact about life itself, that life is not perfect and it will never be. This life is full of trials and tribulations, and we need to accept the whole package, whether you like it or you don't like it. Our life on earth will not be an easy ride. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Mulk, الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور. The one who created death and life in order to test which one of you is best in deeds. And he is the Almighty, the All-Forgiving. This combination between Al-Aziz and Al-Ghafoor is a beautiful combination, and it has many beautiful meanings that are connected to it. And these names are, of course, they have to do with our deeds as humans, whether we are mu'mins or we are kafir, but this is a different story. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about life and death. When a new baby is born, we celebrate life. And everyone in his or her family is happy. When we lose a loved one, we grieve and we feel the pain. And between the two events, humanity is being tested. And at the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will distinguish between the winners and the losers. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. النتيجة يوم القيامة. النتيجة يعرفها الناس يوم القيامة. وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and we test you with evil and with good by way of trial. And then to us you will be returned. That the ultimate destination is to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. أحد علماء التفسير يقول معنى هذه الآية نبلوهم بما يحبون وبما يكرهون نختبرهم بذلك لننظر كيف شكرهم فيما يحبون وكيف صبرهم فيما يكرهون. One of the scholars of tafsir, he said about this ayah, he said, we test you with what you like and what you dislike as well, to see how thankful you are with what you like and how patient you are when facing what you dislike. So when you face hardship and you face something difficult, how patient you are. Are you going to leave Islam from day one? Disconnect yourself from the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from day one? Or you endure that hardship for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is a general wisdom behind trials and tribulations in this life. When it comes to the personal level, and here this khutbah is actually related to the last khutbah I spoke here
about the divine protection that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised to protect the believers and to protect their rights. Inna Allah yudafi'u 'anil ladhina amanu. So some people might ask, why then Allah allow suffering or allow these bad things to happen to the believers? He promised that He will protect them. Inna Allah yudafi'u 'anil ladhina amanu. So we need some understanding here. There is a whole package that we need to take and we need to understand and look into it. إذا الله وعد أن يدافع عن المؤمنين لماذا تقع هذه المشاكل يواجهها المسلمون وبعضهم يموت وبعضهم يدخل السجون وبعضهم وبعضهم وبعضهم. So ما هو الجواب؟ On a personal level, the believer, the mu'min, could be tested for different reasons. And all of them are meant to what? To purify his or her souls. To purify his or her soul. And to prepare them to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's all good. To meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without the burden of sins and shortcomings. So a believer who is not perfect could be falling behind due to his heedlessness and love for this worldly life. At times we forget, and we are humans, and this is a reality. We cannot ignore it. At times we forget about the true purpose of life. And we forget about our ultimate goal, which is Jannah. So during this state of heedlessness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might send a reminder to the believer. And this reminder could be in the form of a calamity or hardship. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مثلا سورة الأعراف, وَبَلَوْنَاهُمْ بِالْحَسَنَاتِ وَالسَّيِّئَاتِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. There are maybe 6 or 7 ayats in the Quran that ended with this, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. العلماء كلهم قول لعلهم يرجعون لعلهم يتوبون. في تقصير, في ذنوب. فالله سبحانه وتعالى يريدك أن ترجع وأن تتوب لعلهم يرجعون. هنا يتكلم الله سبحانه وتعالى عن بني إسرائيل, هم كانوا أتباع الأنبياء مسلمين قدامى الذين اتبعوا يعقوب عليه السلام وموسى وغيره من الأنبياء كانوا مسلمين. فالله سبحانه وتعالى يقول وبلوناهم بالحسنات. الحسنات هي ليست الأعمال الصالحة, الحسنات يعني الخير, الصحة والعافية والرزق والأولاد. والسيئات, ما هي السيئات؟ الابتلاءات, المرض, الفقر, الموت وغيرها من الابتلاءات.
طيب,
وبلوناهم بالحسنات والسيئات لعلهم يرجعون. الله سبحانه وتعالى said in this ayah in surah al-A'raf, and we tested them with blessings and misfortunes, blessings and misfortunes, that they may return to us, they may repent, they may return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with repentance, with tawbah and obedience. And ya ikhwan, believe me, I know some brothers. I know them personally. I know their personal stories because they told me about their personal stories. They had money, they had business, they had everything they wish in this life. But they told me, we forgot about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We were not praying on time. We neglected the religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us some reminders. And we went through some trials. Someone, wallahi, told me, I lost everything. I have now a small income, small source of income, but I am happy because I came back to Allah. I'm praying on time. And of course, don't take me wrong. We don't have to invite hardship and calamities into our life so we can become better Muslims. There is another way to become a better Muslim without going through trials and tribulations. I'll talk about this misconception at the end of the khutbah. But the point is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might send some reminders to some people. And it is for their own benefit, because they remember, they make tawbah, they make a positive change in their life, and they become happy. Yes, they lost everything. They lost money, they lost their business, but they're happy because they are satisfied with the end result. They came back to Allah, they are able to come to the masjid and pray on time with Muslims. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا لكل خير. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه غفور رحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear brothers and sisters, at times a believer could be, that's another type of ابتلاء, another type of testing and trial. A mu'min could be fulfilling his duties and following the right path. Rasulullah ﷺ told us about this case. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that his deeds and his actions are not enough to take him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for him a higher rank in Jannah. He has decreed, مثلاً, so and so will be in Jannah al-Firdaus. But he knows that his deeds, this person, this specific person, particular person, his deeds, his actions are not enough to take him to that manzila, to take him to that rank in Jannah al-Firdaus, for example. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will actually test him with some trials and tribulations, and he will enable him to be patient, to endure those trials and tribulations, so he can erase all his sins and grant him higher degrees. And then at the end, he will be deserving, well deserving of that rank in Jannah. In that regard, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in a famous hadith that is found in Sunan Abi Dawood and some other sources, he said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا سَبَقَتْ لَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَنْزِلَةً سَبَقَتْ لَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَنْزِلَةً لَمْ يَبْلُغْهَا بِعَمَلِهِ. يعني عمله كان قاصر, صلاته, صومه, صدقته لا توصله إلى تلك المنزلة التي كتبها الله له, منزلة عالية جدا. It's all for good. فابتلاه الله, يقول الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام, ابتلاه الله في بدنه أو في ماله أو في ولده, يبتليه الله ثم يصبره الله على هذا الابتلاء حتى يبلغ المنزل التي كتبها الله له. So Allah, رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said in this famous hadith, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has previously decreed a higher rank for his servant and his actions are not enough to take him to this higher rank, his actions are not enough, he had some shortcomings, so what will happen? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test him, try him with in his body or his wealth or his children. And he enables him to endure that. He enables him to be patient. So then he will deserve the rank that was previously decreed. He will be well deserving of the rank that Allah, that was previously decreed for him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the hikam, the wisdom behind allowing these bad things to happen to the believers. When we understand the hikmah, we should be thankful. We should be satisfied with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But of course, in the last khutbah we said, we need to also to do our part. We need to tie our camels. We need to tie our camels. Now, مثلاً, 2 days ago, there was another attack against two sisters in the city of Edmonton. And it was a hate crime, classified as a hate crime. The person attacked these two Muslim sisters, I think they were sisters from the same family, because of who they are. They were wearing hijab with a knife. Alhamdulillah, You know, there were no casualties. One of them was taken to the hospital with with some injuries, non-life-threatening injuries, and the other one has sustained some minor injuries. But still, it is a hate crime, and we have to be careful about, you know, we have to take care of our sisters now, our daughters, our wives. If your daughter is going walking to school, maybe you should consider giving her a ride now. Maybe you shouldn't allow your daughter to walk in the park by herself these days. They should be in a group with a family. We have to exercise some extra caution. We have to pay attention to our surroundings. And also du'as. I always emphasize the importance and the power of du'a. In the last khutbah, I would like to remind you, there are some beautiful, powerful supplications that are meant, this is what I'm here, pay attention to this, they are meant for protection. We're not talking about general du'as. We're not talking about general supplications. We're talking about du'as that are meant for protection. Right? You need to memorize them, teach them to your kids, say them. There are du'as that we need to see, supposed to say, recite every day. Whenever you leave your house, you say a du'a. Whenever you go to any place, there is a du'a that you say. Right? And nothing will happen to you, as promised by Rasulullah ﷺ, until you leave that place. We believe in the promise of our Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I don't memorize these du'as, I don't memorize them, I don't check them, I don't look for them, and something happened to me, then I have to blame myself, right? But I do this, I do my part, then whatever happens, then it was decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, as I said, are we supposed to invite hardship and calamities into our life to be better Muslims? No. This was not the methodology of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to encourage Muslims to ask and pray for well-being all the time. In a famous hadith, he said, لا تتمنوا لقاء العدو. Do not wish to meet your enemy. وسألوا الله العافية. Pray for well-being. Ask Allah to grant you well-being. فَإِذَا لَقِيتُمُوهُمْ فَاصْبِرُوا. But if you meet your enemy, if you face your enemy, then stand your ground and be patient and stay firm. But do not wish to meet your enemy. This is what Rasulullah ﷺ said. One time there was one man, one Sahabi, who was extremely sick. He lost weight and he was extremely sick at home. Couldn't walk, he couldn't go out. Rasulullah ﷺ went to visit him. Look at this philosophy. So he asked him, you were not making any dua? Yahi, just switch off your cell phone, switch it off. And there is an option, we should have an option in our phone to switch it off completely. So Rasulullah ﷺ asked him, you didn't have any dua, you didn't use any dua, you were not making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you with good health and to grant you well-being. Look at what this man said. He said, I had a dua. What was your dua? He was saying, Ya Allah, whatever punishment you have saved for me on the day of judgment, then give it to me in this dunya. His intention was good. His intention is good, but the understanding is wrong. The intention is good. This man wants to be saved on the day of judgment. He wants to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without the burden of sins or shortcomings. Whatever punishment is there, just give it to me in this dunya. I'm happy with that. And grant me well-being on the day on al-akhirah, the year after. So Rasulullah said, he said, Subhanallah, innaka la tutiquhu. He said, Subhanallah, you cannot handle that. You should have said, ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. Oh Allah, grant us good in this world and good in the hereafter, and save us from the punishment of hellfire. There is a famous story in the books of history. And Imam Ibn Kathir narrated this story in his book. I'm not making up this story, but it's a very interesting story. It is found in Al-Bidayah wal-Nihayah that was authored by Imam Ibn Kathir, and it was mentioned by some other scholars. There was a Abid, someone who was heavily involved in Ibadah, in Basra. They said in the books of history that he used to pray, offer 500 rak'ahs every 24 hours, day and night. I thought about it, I said maybe it's possible. They didn't have internet, they didn't have Instagram, they didn't have Facebook, no Twitter, no TV. I mean, yeah, maybe it's possible, 500 rak'ahs. If he had an income, he was able to secure an income, other people working for him, maybe. He had free time. Maybe 500 rak'ahs, right? And this man used to make a statement. كان يقول ربي ابتليني بما شئت فليس لي في سواك حظ. Oh Allah, test me with whatever test you want, whatever trial you want. I have no attachment towards anyone beside you. And this is a big statement. The second part is good. I have no attachment towards anyone beside you, right? To anyone beside you. Which means my heart is completely attached to you, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he used to be known for this. He used to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He used to make poetry about loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on and so forth. But the first part of the statement, test me with whatever you want, it's a big statement. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him. I believe it's a small test. He didn't go to jail. He was not detained for 20 years. He was not tortured in jail. He didn't live in Syria or in Egypt nowadays. No, it was a small test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him with a disease, acute urinary retention. He was not able to pee in a normal way. He was not able to relieve himself. And it was very painful for 2 weeks. Then he realized that he made a mistake. He shouldn't have made that statement. And he used to go to the kids in Quranic schools in the city of Baghdad and give them food and give them candy. And he used to say, "Ud'u li'ammikum al-kadhab," make dua for your uncle, the liar. Because he realized that it was not a good statement. You shouldn't ask. You shouldn't, you know, show this attitude. No, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for well-being. So now, and this is what Al-Abbas used to come to his radiallahu anhu, to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was his uncle. Ya Rasulullah, tell me about a good dua. I want a beautiful dua. Give me a dua that I can use every day. And he said, سَلِلَّهِ الْعَافِيَةِ, ask Allah, pray to Allah to grant you well-being. Abbas was not radiallahu anhu satisfied with this dua. The next day he came, Ya Rasulullah, I want some special dua. A special dua, Ya Rasulullah. What was his response? Ya Abbas, Ya Amma Rasulillah. Oh Abbas, oh the uncle of the Messenger of Allah. Listen, ask Allah, pray to Allah for well-being, to grant you well-being. So there is nothing that is better than Al-Afiyah. Because if you are tested, you don't know if you will be patient or not. You don't know how you're going to react. So the best policy is to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for well-being, work for well-being, use these du'as and supplications that are meant for protection and for well-being. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا لكل خير. اللهم اغفر لنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم ارحم ضعفنا واجبر كسرنا يسر أمرنا ردنا جميعا إلى كتابك وسنة نبيك عليه الصلاة والسلام. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ونسألك قلبا خاشعا ونسألك رزقا واسعا. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في ديننا ودنيانا. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم احفظ جاليتنا من كل سوء، احفظ بناتنا وزوجاتنا، واحفظ ذرياتنا بحفظك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنك خير حافظ، اللهم إنك خير حافظ، اللهم إنك خير حافظ. اللهم احفظنا في ديننا، احفظنا في أزواجنا، احفظنا في أولادنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين، إنك خير الحافظين. والحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقم الصلاة.